Hello everyone! I will kick off my YouTube series about explained AI methods and papers with the question, how do we check if a neural network has learned to solve task A? Well, the answer for this question is not so interesting. Since we have trained the neural network for solving A, we have training data for A. Then we test how well the network solves A on the held out test data, and we are done. No, come on, let us ask something more interesting. How do we check if a neural network trained on task A has learned a phenomenon specific to task B? And we will give the answer focusing on NLP, but it is generalizable to many other applications like computer vision. Since the AI field is changing so rapidly, this video is a snapshot of the current state of research. Simultaneously, it is my attempt to explain intriguing and sometimes complicated concepts that researchers use every day in a simple and understandable manner. So let's get back to the original question. How do we check if a neural network trained on task A has learned a phenomenon specific to task B? We start here with a neural network, and supposing it was trained on large amounts of training data like on Wikipedia, where it reads the text and has to predict masked words.
Can a neural network read?
This masked word prediction is our task A. Because predicting masked words by a neural network has been lately proven to be extremely effective on many other tasks, apparently unrelated to masked word prediction, we want to test this. Is it true that if the neural network trained to complete missing parts of text has also captured interesting linguistic phenomena? And before we can answer this question, we have to choose one phenomenon we want to probe for. Checking if and how much a neural network trained on task A captures a specific linguistic phenomenon is referred to by terms like probing or diagnostic classifier or probing task B. So the task B comprises the linguistic phenomenon we want to test for here. Keeping it simple now, I will use the example of sentiment expressed in text, where the text is no longer than a paragraph. And here the neural network has to tell us if a paragraph expresses positive sentiment or negative sentiment. The example could be anything else, from the grammaticality of a sentence to natural language inference. Now, back again to our original question, how do we check if a neural network trained on task A has learned a phenomenon specific to task B? We wonder, how do researchers try to answer this question? Well, with probing. Okay, and how do we probe? We take the network as is, trained on task A, and remove the last part, the one that was responsible for mapping all the weights encoding patterns in the data for making the final prediction. Now, to test if this part can also do sentiment classification, we then replace the last layers with another fresh classifier that has not yet been trained to do anything. It cannot map the original parameters of the network to sentiment classification. Okay, then let's train it to. In order to keep everything preserved that we have trained from task A, we freeze, so leave unchanged, the old part of the network, and this fresh part we train. And we train it on a relatively small dataset of sentiment classification, our task B, containing paragraphs labeled with positive or negative sentiment. And in this scenario, the new classifier, our probe, is performing binary classification, where the output is either 0 for negative sentiment or 1 for positive sentiment. From the way the probe trains, we differentiate between the following scenarios. If the classifier trained on the small dataset for probing is learning fast and performing well, then the weights we left unchanged have been already capturing the information of the probe task. In the second, worse scenario, if the classifier trained on this small dataset is not learning anything and is barely performing better than when it is untrained, then the weights of the big neural network have been not capturing any information about the probing task at all, or so it seems. Okay now, If we would ignore the most recent research, we would stop here. And if you clicked on this video for getting the answer to the original question of how do we check if a neural network has learned something in NLP, then you are ready to go, since we explained how it works on the example of sentiment analysis. And the same procedure holds for many other phenomena and is not even restricted to NLP. Now in the following, I will be addressing the contribution of a recent paper where they address following problems. Neural networks in general tend to overfit, meaning that they specialize on a certain task, memorizing input and output. And this problem gets even bigger where the size of our training set is small. And this is usually the case for our probing task B. Overfitting happens with our probing classifier, where it is able to learn the new probing task, but is also able to learn a completely random probing task, where the labels have been randomly altered. Also, sometimes the expected difference between an untrained probe and the trained one is not as big as expected. Can the authors do something to save the standard probing from its problems? Oh yes, they do. They use an information-theoretic view. And since this might sound intimidating, the idea is elegant and yet so simple. Additionally to measuring how many times the neural network with the trained probe can give right or wrong answers, they check if the neural network can also efficiently transmit the data. This means, if we call our neural network Bob and the probing classifier Alice, Alice is then the person receiving the answers of Bob and mapping them to labels. And Bob sees some data, processes it through the neural network and sends its output to Alice. So Alice receives a message, tries to decode it and reconstruct the right label, and gives him credit if she could decode the right label from Bob's message. But instead of measuring only the capability of Bob and Alice cooperatively getting to the right answer, we are now additionally measuring how well Bob could send the message in a short, compressed form, for which we would assume he had to understand more and see patterns in this world. So, if you liked this information-theoretic approach and you want to know more, read the paper. It is so well written that it is really a pleasure to read. I have linked it in the description of the video below. Thanks for watching, do not forget to like and subscribe, and see you next time!